Hello, this is the Midday News update from our Vox Africa studios here in London. I'm Pamela Bonkyung. We kick off with South Africa, where Nathim Tetwa, South Africa's police minister, visited the location where a Mozambican taxi driver was dragged to his death yesterday. Nine policemen have been charged with Mido Masio's death, a charge which they've pleaded not guilty to. However, footage from an onlooker's cell phone, which has been circulating on the internet, shows 27-year-old Masio being dragged behind a police car. Most residents in the township have complained of police harassment and say the government has done little to allay their fears. According to the protesters, the minister's visit is of no importance, given that he listens to the police who perpetrated this act.
We came to pay our respect, really, to express to the family our sincere condolences about what happened to Mido, and that's the main reason why we're here. We'll do everything to fight for the preservation of the relationship between the community and the police, because without that, there would be no peace, there would be escalation of crime in our country.
The family of South African model Reeva Steenkamp have spoken for the first time about coming to terms with her death. Reeva Steenkamp, who was Blade Runner Oscar Pistorius's girlfriend, was shot by Pistorius on the eve of February 14th. Pistorius, who secured bail under strict conditions, now lives with his uncle in Pretoria. Reeva's family are looking to set up a legacy project to keep her spirit alive. Ms. Steenkamp's family have spoken of how down-to-earth the model was, despite her good looks.
Every day I pinch myself, and it's not very nice realizing what has actually happened, you know, and who it is everybody's talking about. You sit at work and your mind is somewhere else, and the next minute you hear on the radio something about Steenkamp or Reeva.
As a family's point of view, she was our center, our glue. She was the youngest, so, you know, but she was the biggest in the sense that she was the one that always wanted to make sure the family were together.
Her beauty on the outside was, once you met her, because that was what initially attracted you at first, but once you met her and you spent a couple of minutes with her, you didn't even see that anymore because this amazing personality came out.
The fact is that she was their life, and she was very close to both the parents and sought their advice and on anything she did, and basically, and they sought her advice on what they were doing. So to not have that special person to call or to talk about or know that you're never going to see, they're battling with it, yes.
An angel on earth. That would be what I would say. An angel on earth.
The United Nations Security Council voted on Thursday to extend the UN mission in Libya for a further 12 months. The draft resolution was unanimously adopted by Security Council members led by Acting President Vitaly Chorkin. The resolution should make it easier for Libya to obtain non-lethal equipment such as bulletproof vests and armored cars. It also revised the arms embargo imposed at the start of an uprising in 2011 that culminated in the ousting of leader Muammar Gaddafi. Libya's Prime Minister welcomed this news.
The government is continuing cooperation with the team of the United Nations working there, and we are quite happy to renew its mandate in Libya for the next 12 months.
An Egyptian Coptic church in the eastern Libyan city of Benghazi was set ablaze on Thursday by unknown assailants. According to officials, no one was injured as the church was empty. But the building was ransacked and completely charred by the fire. This is the second attack on the building in weeks. Residents said the attack is in retaliation to a protest of the death of an Egyptian Copt in an explosion about a month ago in front of a church in Libya. Now, in Togo's capital, Lomé, police had to use tear gas on Thursday to disperse protesting journalists in front of the presidency. The journalists are protesting a new media law which allows the media regulator power to punish them. Media organizations say the bill passed by Parliament will completely erode their press freedom. However, the Togolese authorities have rejected the idea, saying the powers given to the Supreme Audiovisual and Communications Authority will mitigate the excesses noted in the media world. Now on Thursday, French President François Hollande announced that France will go ahead to support the Syrians if other European counterparts were not keen. He made the remarks at the EU Leaders' Summit as the EU still continues to look into the arms embargo, which many are wary of lifting. German Chancellor Angela Merkel has urged caution, saying that it was risky business to supply one side with weapons. Many Syrian refugees are set to face a third year in hungry exile as today marks the end of the second year, since the uprising against Bashar al-Assad begun. The United Nations World Food Programme has reiterated the severe challenges most of the refugees continue to encounter in the camps. The World Food Programme and other agencies are struggling to house, feed and care for an estimated 1 million Syrian refugees who have spilled out from the conflict into neighboring countries, including northern Iraq, in the Domis camp. A voucher program in the camp has been providing food to some 30,000 Syrian refugees.
We're here in the Domis camp in northern Iraq, where most people have fled from Qamishli and rural Qamishli in northern Syria. We're actually functioning inside northern Syria as well, so we are supporting the families that these people have left behind inside Syria, as well as the people that have sought refuge here in northern Iraq.
Pope Francis began his papacy with Mass, but the talk has been mostly of his simple ways. He shunned a pontiff's limousine to get on the bus with all the other cardinals and seems set on walking to most of his destination if he can. During his homily, he asked the church to engage in more prayers. Most faithful in the Vatican have admired Pope Francis's resilience, living with just one lung since the age of 21.
He was operated on one lung. The lung was not taken out completely. I believe he was 21 years old when it happened, and that is quite a long time ago, and he's lived very comfortably and very well with that medical issue all of these years. There are several people here who are from Argentina that know him. Jesuits and others have worked with him, and they can attest that he's in very good shape.
China has welcomed its new prime minister, Liu Keqiang, who is taking over from Wen Jiabao. Well known for his reformist tendencies, Liu Keqiang is respected for his canning ability of being approachable, though he has displayed ruthlessness when it is needed to protect the Chinese Communist Party. Keqiang came from very humble beginnings and rose through the ranks to become one of the most powerful politicians in the country. His promotion to premier was endorsed by 3,000 legislators at the National People's Congress. Let's see something different about Libya in the entertainment industry. Break dancing as far as becoming popular among the country's youth. Dance groups recently staged a competition in Tripoli. It was the fourth time such a contest was being held, with another staged 2 weeks ago in Benghazi. Dancers in Libya are finding more opportunities to perform around the country since the fall of Muammar Gaddafi. According to the organizers, they want breakdowns to become well recognized in the Arab world and also to fight marginalization of Libyans too.
We want breakdance in Libya to be known in the Arab world and to participate in Arab competition, because we marginalized and they do not know anything about us. They don't know that there is a breakdance in Libya and we practice and know this style. But we hope they will know this and that we have breakdance so that they will invite us for competitions.
Meanwhile, at Indian Wells, California, the BNP Paribas Tennis Open Rafael Nadal has breezed into the semifinals by beating Roger Federer, who crushed the Swiss 6-4, 6-2 at the quarterfinals yesterday. Nadal will next face the Czech Tomas Berdych, who reached his first semifinals by beating South African Kevin Anderson 6-4, 6-4. The game is taking an interesting turn, and we will update as the Open proceeds. Now, Federer remained positive about his game, even though he admitted it was a tough tournament.
Sure, this is a very, very important victory for me, you know, coming back in a hardcore tournament and being in semifinals is just amazing, very, very happy for everything. I don't know if Roger felt that he's 100% tonight, but if not, sorry for him. I wish him a good recover and quick.
Normally I'd like to practice real hard and, you know, rest up and recover from this week. It's been a really difficult week for me, so I'm happy to have played a decent tournament and overall, under the circumstances, I'm happy, you know. So it's all right and looking forward. I'll probably maintain my schedule, but you never know. But
Well, I mean, that I didn't drop a set, I think it's just a small bonus on top of it. And, you know, to be the first time semi-final, it's just great for me, you know. I mean, it's...
Well, that'll be all for now. Stay tuned to Vox Africa, and we shall see you in a moment with more news updates.